afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, Wage and Hour Compliance Update, Changing the Rules of the Game. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. And I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Walters Core for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those of you that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have an additional slide at the end to serve as instruction on how to access certification. And lastly, before I introduce today's speakers, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. And before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we are discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. And also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Sushma Trafi and Stacey Williams. Sushma serves as Vice President in ADP's Strategic Advisory Services. She is responsible for workforce management consulting and thought leadership to support ADP clients across all human capital management services. She brings more than two decades of experience in leadership, operations, and product management, primarily in health and productivity management, employee benefits administration, and wellness outsourcing. Stacey is compliance counsel for ADP National Account Services. Stacey has been a practicing attorney for nearly 20 years, representing employers both at large law firms and as in-house counsel. She is a frequent speaker on topics related to employment law and compliance. With that, Sushma, I know you and Stacey have a lot to talk about today, so I'm going to turn the event over to you.
Well, thank you, Karen, and welcome everyone to today's session on Wage and Hour Compliance Update, Changing the Rules of the Game. Now, we have a rich agenda today, and we will be covering a variety of topics, starting with some of the key statistics and trends for the Fair Labor Standard Act by looking at the last 10 years of enforcement data covering from 2009 to 2018. And then we will cover the Fair Labor Standards Act, or the FLSA basics, as well as exemption and duties tests. We will also provide you with an update of the FLSA proposed regulations, including the information we have on white-collar exemptions, minimum salary threshold, which was the proposed increase blocked by the courts in 2016, and then the DOL's new proposed regulations, including information on what is included in the regular rate of pay calculation. We will also cover minimum wage and overtime regulations, provide federal and state examples, and how to calculate a regular rate of pay with a California example. Now, in addition to that, we will cover special topics of interest to you, for example, meals and rest breaks, split shifts, as well as fair or predictive scheduling laws. Now, we will also discuss compliance considerations and cover different types of wage and hour lawsuits and general best practices, and then we will close with future outlook, things that you need to keep an eye out for. So, you know, with that said, let's take a look at some of the enforcement trends around the FLSA. Now, the first graph reflects the DOL enforcement statistics when it comes to FLSA minimum wage violation. Now, on your screen, you can see the graph from the Wage and Hour Division of the U.S. Department of Labor. Also, you can see the link to the DOL site at the bottom of your screen. Now, this graph displays back wages paid for minimum wage rate violations in the last 10 years, from 2009 to 2018. And in general, you will notice that the total number of cases with violations for minimum wage rose during the Obama era. In the first 4 years, if you look at the graph, you can see a steady increase in the back wage cases, and then a slight decrease year over year through 2017 at 10,687 cases, amounting to, say, about, you know, over $31 million in penalty. And then in 2018, the number of cases with violations went down slightly at 10,071, which was down by 600 cases. But it's really interesting to note that the penalty actually went up, amounting to over $32 million. Which is, say, about $1.1 million more than 2017. So the bottom line is that the minimum wage violations continue to pose a huge risk and concern for employers. So let's go to our first polling question. And so here's the question for our audience. It is regarding overtime back wages recovered by the DOL. So the question is, has the amount of back wages for overtime violations recovered by the DOL under the Trump administration, has it gone up or down compared with the amount recovered under the Obama administration? So you have three choices. So the first choice is it stayed the same, or it's gone up, or it's gone down, and you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you, Sushma, so much. And just my one reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure that you respond to the question to qualify. If for some reason the polling is not showing up for you, you can put your answer in the Q&A text field as well. I'm going to give you all a few more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Well, so about a little less than half of you, 47.9%, have said it's gone up. Now, the correct answer is in the second graph, so let's go to that. Now this graph shows the DOL enforcement statistics on the FLSA overtime violations, and here you can see the amount of back wages recovered by the DOL for violations related to overtime for the same period of time, basically those last 10 years that we looked at before, and it shows that the amount of back wages recovered by the DOL in 2018 were actually significantly higher than in the past years. And in general, the total number of cases with violations for overtime have gone up significantly from 8,792 in 2009, amounting to $119 million, to 11,018 in 2018, amounting to about, say, $194 million in 2018. And that is basically a $75 million increase. And that says it all and really shows why this is such a hot topic and why today we have over 8,800 people registered for our webinar today. So now that we understand the importance of keeping in compliance, let's start with the basics. You know, what's required under the federal FLSA? So as most of you know, the federal FLSA, I'm sorry, the screen not getting to the next page. And I'm going to try it one more time. So as most of you know, the Fair Labor Standard Act is a federal law that includes requirements that certain employees be paid minimum wage And then they also be paid time and a half for hours worked in excess of 40 per work week. Now, some employees are exempt from these rules, but in order to be exempt, an employee needs to meet certain requirements. Now, the most common FLSA exemptions are the so-called white-collar exemptions, that is the executive, the administrative, and professional exemptions. So, Stacey, can you tell us a little bit about what tests an employee must meet to be considered exempt under the white-collar exemption?
Sure. To be exempt from the minimum wage and overtime requirements of the FLSA under one of the white-collar exemptions, an employee needs to meet the requirements of three separate tests. The salary basis test requires that an employee must be paid on a salary basis. So this is pretty straightforward, but it does mean that employers can't take certain deductions from the wages of these salaried employees, or the employees could lose the right to be considered exempt. The salary level test requires that employees must earn a certain minimum salary in order to be considered exempt. And the duties test requires that employees must meet certain requirements pertaining to their job duties.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, on your screen, you can see a high-level overview of the duties test for the three most common white-collar exemptions that we just went through. Now, this topic is highly fact-specific and so complex that we could do a webinar on just the duties test alone, but we have more material to cover, so let's take a look at some of the recent developments in the wage and hour field. But before we move on, one point I'd like to make regarding the administrative exemption is that this is a bit of a gray area. Now, the key feature is that the performance of office or non-manual work directly related to management or general business operations of the employer or the employer's customers and must include the exercise of discretion and independent judgment with respect to matters of significance. Now, matters of significance can be tricky, so let me give you an example. Now, choosing between ordering blue or black pens for an administrative assistant is really not a matter of significance. So let's move on to our next section on federal wage and hour development. Now, to start our discussion, we have our second polling question for you. So this question is, you know, which change to the FLSA was proposed by the Department of Labor in 2019? And you have three choices. Your choices are the Department of Labor had, you know, proposed raising the federal minimum wage rate to $15 per hour, or the DOL has not made any new proposals due to changes in leadership, or the DOL has proposed increasing the minimum salary threshold for the white-collar exemptions to the FLSA. Now, again, like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and your clock starts now.
Thank you again, Sushma. I'm just going to give my second CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please respond to the question to qualify. Let me give you all a few more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should see the results on the screen now.
Well, sure. So it appears like 62% of you have chosen the third answer. So it seems like almost everyone knew that the DOL has proposed increasing the minimum salary threshold for the white-collar exemptions to the FLSA. So, Stacey, can you give us a little bit more of a history on this?
Sure. So our audience probably remembers that back in 2016, the DOL issued new regulations that would have increased the minimum salary for employees classified under the white-collar exemptions to the FLSA. So today, to be considered exempt under any of the white-collar exemptions, the current minimum salary threshold is $455 a week, which amounts to an annual salary of $23,660 per year. And this threshold has not increased since 2004. The 2016 proposal would have increased the minimum salary for white-collar exempt employees to $913 a week, or $47,476 annually. Now, that rule, however, was blocked by a federal court, and the DOL under the Trump administration declined to continue to defend the prior proposal. So back in March of 2019, the DOL released a new proposal to increase the minimum salary threshold for white-collar exempt employees to an amount not quite as high as was proposed under the previous administration. And that proposal is summarized on your screen, and we will dig into this proposed change a bit deeper in the next couple of slides.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, here you're looking at the visual representation of the FLSA weekly and annual salary thresholds. Now, you can see the current level on the top and the 2016 proposed increase in the middle, and the bottom row actually shows you the 2019 proposal by the DOL. And as you can see, the proposed rate of $679 per week, which is higher than the current weekly threshold of $455 per week, but not nearly as high as the 2016 increase would have been. So that's just interesting, to note. And then to further illustrate the effect of the proposal, we have our third polling question for our audience. Now, this is a simple question. The answer is either true or false. So the question is, if you have a current employee who is classified as exempt under the administrative exemption, who's making $29,000 a year, they will no longer be eligible for the administrative exemption when the new salary threshold takes into effect. And again, the answers are either true or false. And like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you, Sushma. Just going to give you all a few more seconds to respond and give my usual CPE credit reminder. For those of you that would like credit, please make sure you respond. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Well, most people believe that the statement is true. So, Stacey, what is the correct answer?
The answer is true, because even with the modification proposed to allow bonuses to count towards some of the minimum salary threshold, which we'll talk about in a second, there's no way that a salary of $29,000 can meet the new minimum requirement. So the 2019 proposal would allow up to 10% of the minimum salary level to be satisfied with non-discretionary bonuses, commissions, and other incentive pay that's paid annually or more frequently. So such bonuses include, for example, non-discretionary incentive bonuses tied to productivity and profitability. Although some businesses pay significantly larger bonuses, where such large bonuses are paid, the amount attributable to the white-collar exemption standard salary level is nevertheless capped at 10% of the required salary amount. So you can see on your screen, if an employer applies a non-discretionary bonus or incentive pay towards the salary threshold, at least 90% of that salary, which amounts to $611 per week, must be paid as salary, while up to 10% of the amount, or $68 a week, can be satisfied with non-discretionary bonuses or incentive payments. So that works out to a minimum of $31,777.20 in salary and up to $3,530 in non-discretionary bonuses, incentive payments, or commissions per year.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So in our example then, an individual making $29,000 in annual salary will no longer meet the minimum salary requirement for the administrative exemption of the FLSA. So, Stacey, what do our employers, who are listening to us today, need to think about?
Sure. Well, so as you can see on your screen, employers will want to consider the impact of the increase in salary for all of their employees who fall in the category of between the current minimum salary amount and the proposed salary amount.
So employers are going to need to consider whether they want to reclassify those people as non-exempt and therefore be required to track all of their hours worked, and they'll be eligible for overtime and everything that goes with being non-exempt, or whether they want to raise the salary for these employees to a level that will meet the increased minimum salary requirements. Now, employers should be mindful that the discussion that we're having here only applies at the federal level, as many states have their own minimum salary thresholds for exemption, and many of these have increased in 2019. We also want our audience to be aware that in some states, employees may be exempt only from the overtime requirements, meaning that they still would need to be paid at least the state minimum wage for all hours worked. And of course, I'm sure our audience already knows that many state minimum wages have also increased in 2019, which would need to be taken into consideration.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So, you know, let's shift gears and take a look at the highly compensated tests. Now here, you can see the current required salary for the employees who meet the highly compensation exemption, and that is $100,000. Now the increase proposed in 2016 was $134,004, and in 2019, it is $147,414. And as you can see, the salary amount proposed for the highly compensated employee exemption in 2019 is actually higher than what that was proposed in 2016, which is interesting to note. Now, another difference between the 2016 and 2019 proposals is in the area of automatic increases to the minimum salary threshold. Now, under the 2016 proposal, the minimum salary threshold would have increased automatically. However, under the 2019 proposed rule, the amount would not automatically increase, but rather the DOL proposes to review the minimum salary threshold every 4 years. And that way, before the new increase will take effect, the DOL will have to go through notice and comment rulemaking. So, you know, you're going to have to keep an eye out for that as well. So Stacey, you know, the DOL also issued some proposed regulations related to the types of compensation that do not need to be included in calculating the employee's regular rate of pay. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Right. So we know that the regular rate is not just a non-exempt employee's hourly or base rate of pay, but rather it includes all remuneration for employment unless it's specifically excluded by the FLSA. So the regular rate proposal that we've seen from the DOL really just confirms what most of us already suspected as far as certain types of compensation that do not need to be included when calculating an employee's regular rate of pay. So the FLSA already expressly excludes some types of compensation from the regular rate, such as vacation or holiday pay, the cost of health insurance, employer contributions to retirement accounts, and reimbursements for business expenses. So the new proposal from the DOL would just confirm that the types of employer-provided benefits that you see on your screen also may be excluded from the computation of the regular rate of pay.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, we recently heard that the DOL suggested a change to the rules concerning the use of the fluctuating workweek method. So, Stacey, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, that is a very recent development. Just last week, the DOL issued a notice of proposed rulemaking around the fluctuating workweek method of calculating overtime. So the fluctuating workweek method allows employers to pay a fixed weekly salary to some non-exempt employees whose hours tend to vary from week to week. The employer then pays overtime at one-half the employee's base rate of pay for each hour of overtime worked in a week. As that rule exists today, its application is limited, and not many employers rely on this calculation. We don't really have a lot of detail so far around what the DOL is proposing, but based on what we do know, it appears that the department is considering allowing employers to count other types of compensation towards overtime payments to make this method more attractive to employers as an option. Now, we do just want to note that the fluctuating workweek method is a bit tricky, and employers who are considering relying on it should really consult with counsel to make sure they're doing it correctly. And stay tuned for more details on this proposal as they become available.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So let's, you know, for that update on the DOL proposed overtime regulation. So let's move on to our current overtime and discuss minimum wage rates. So there's a lot of activity here at the state and local level, which can be confusing for employers who have multiple locations. And, you know, we've already talked about some of the rules under the federal law, that is the overtime is calculated at time and a half, at the regular rate of pay for hours worked over 40 per the work week. And you can see additional federal requirements summarized on your screen. However, various states have their own rules regarding overtime, which can be more complex than the federal rule. Now, on your screen, you can see a few examples of state rules. As you can imagine, in California, the overtime payment is more complex. So, Stacey, to illustrate some of that complexity, can you please go over the requirements for overtime calculation in California?
Sure. So we know that under the FLSA, non-exempt employees are entitled to be paid time and a half for all hours worked in excess of 40 per work week. Well, California has that rule too, but it also adds some additional overtime requirements. Non-exempt employees in California are entitled to daily overtime at time and a half for all hours worked in excess of 8 in a single workday, and to double time for all hours worked in excess of 12 in a single workday. In addition, on the 7th consecutive day in a work week, they're entitled to be paid at time and a half for hours up to 8 and double time for all hours worked in excess of 8. So, for example, if a non-exempt employee in California worked 3 hours on each day of the week, Monday through Saturday, and then worked 5 hours on Sunday of that week, that employee would be entitled to be paid overtime at time and a half for her hours worked on Sunday, even though the employee hasn't even worked 40 total hours in the work week because she worked hours on the 7th consecutive day. And now, so we've discussed some of the California overtime rules just by way of example, but remember that other states have different overtime requirements, such as some of the ones we've listed on your screen.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So let's switch to minimum wage next. Now, as we all know, it has been quite a while since we've seen any increase in the federal minimum wage of $7.25 per hour. But in many cases, the states and cities have filled that void. Now, to show you an example, let's look at the state of California and some cities within California. Now, what you're seeing on your screen is just a sampling of varying minimum wage rates to different locations in California. Now, it's important to remember that an employee could be subject to multiple minimum wage rates based on federal, state, and local laws. And the employer must pay the employee at the rate most favorable or most beneficial to the employee. In other words, the highest applicable minimum wage rate. Now, so far, we've talked about the rules for non-tipped employees, but the rules are slightly different for tipped employees. Under the federal law, there's a separate tipped employee minimum wage for employees who earn tips. Now, currently, that rate is $2.13 per hour. For example, you know, the employer wishing to take the tip credit under the federal law, the tip minimum wage plus the employee's tips must equal to or be in excess of the non-tipped employee's minimum wage rate of $7.25 per hour. Also, in 2011, the DOL issued a regulation that prohibited employers from requiring tip pooling. Now, tip pooling is basically where the tips are shared between the so-called front-of-the-house employees with the back-of-the-house employees who typically don't have direct customer interactions. And in 2018, this rule was rescinded, and employers may once again require tip pooling, provided that no part of the employee's tip may go to the employer. So, Stacey, is this the rule in all of the other states?
Not necessarily. In California and other states, including the ones listed on your screen, there is no separate tipped minimum wage. That is, employees must be paid at least the highest applicable minimum wage, whether they earn tips or not. Another difference between federal law and state law, or at least in California, is that under federal law, employers are permitted to reduce the amount of tips paid out to employees where the tips were left on credit cards by the amount the employer pays to the credit card company for card processing. Now, under California law, for example, employers may not pass on any credit card processing fees to employees. Also, we'd want to point out that a number of states have recently updated their state laws related to paying tipped employees. So if you have tipped employees, it's really important that you keep up with the latest developments in those areas.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So, you know, let's look at some sample state pay requirements for exemption. Now, there are many exemptions under the FLSA, but the most common ones are the executive, administrative, and professional exemptions that we went over a few minutes ago. And states may also have their own requirements for exemptions, which may be different from the federal requirements. And on your screen, you can see a sampling of those state requirements. And if you're a multi-state employer, you actually have to keep an eye out for this as well. So let's switch gears and look at the regular rate of pay again. So we've already spoken a bit about what does and does not need to be included when calculating a non-exempt employee's regular rate of pay under the federal law. And you can see some of those elements listed on your screen. But in general, what's included are pay tied to hours worked, production, or efficiency. Basically, you know, your pay associated with quality or quantity of work. Now, those are the federal requirements. But Stacey, there was a development that affected how the regular rate of pay must be calculated in California. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. So back in March of 2018, the California Supreme Court released an opinion in the case of Alvarado versus Dart Container Corporation of California. And in that case, that California court clarified how employers need to calculate overtime pay where non-exempt employees receive a flat sum bonus. So before this case, most California employers determined the overtime rate by following the formula derived under the FLSA. That is, the regular rate of pay would be determined by dividing the employee's total compensation for the week by that employee's total hours worked in the same week. In Alvarado, however, the California Supreme Court held that where a non-exempt employee earns a flat sum bonus, the regular rate of pay should be determined by allocating that bonus only to non-overtime hours worked during the relevant pay period. Essentially, this means that in weeks when a non-exempt employee in California receives a lump sum bonus, in order to determine the employee's regular rate of pay for overtime purposes, instead of dividing the bonus amount by all the hours the employees worked per week to find the overtime premium, you instead divide the lump sum bonus by only non-overtime hours worked.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So, you know, let's go over a scenario to help clarify how to calculate the regular rate of pay when an employee receives a flat sum bonus. Now here, in this example, you're seeing the employee earns an hourly wage of $12 and a $100 flat sum bonus in a work week, which they work, say, about 50 hours in that week. Now, 40 out of the 50 hours are regular time and 10 hours are weekly overtime. So let's review how you would calculate the weekly overtime under the federal FLSA formula versus the new California formula. Now, in this example, it's a little bit of an eye chart, so I apologize for that. But in this example, you can see the federal formula versus California side by side. Now, it's interesting to note that both federal and California calculations have a four-step process. However, the regular rate of pay will always be higher in California because you are dividing the flat sum bonus by the non-overtime hours worked and then multiplying the per hour bonus by 1.5 and the hourly wage by 1.5 and then adding those products. So, you know, when you think about it, the key difference is that in the federal formula, you divide compensation by the total hours worked, you know, instead of what we just talked about in California. So when you do the math, you can see the total compensation for the week under the federal formula turns out to be $770. Versus in California, it is higher, and it is $797.50. And, you know, this can also be more complex, as this example that I just went through, it does not take into account the daily overtime and the double time that Stacy just mentioned a few minutes ago. So next, you know, we will review some of the special topics, including meal and rest breaks, split shifts, and spread of hour payment requirements with you. So to introduce this topic, you know, we have a fourth and final polling question for you. It relates to meal and rest breaks requirements in the state of California. So the question is, how many meal and rest breaks is an employee entitled to take if they work a 9-hour shift? So you have four choices. The first choice is 2 meal breaks and 2 rest breaks, or 2 meal breaks and 1 rest break, or 1 meal break and 2 rest breaks, or 2 meal breaks and 3 rest breaks. Now you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you, Sushma. And I'm going to give my last CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. Let me give you all about 10 more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
All right, so, well, most people chose number 3, 1 meal break and 2 rest breaks. So before we get to the answer, let's take a look at the federal law. Now, we know that under the federal law, meal periods can be unpaid as long as they last at least 30 minutes without interruption, and the employee is completely relieved of duty in order to eat a meal. But California is different. So, Stacy, what was the correct answer there?
Well, we have one smart audience because the correct answer is 1 meal break and 2 rest breaks. And so as you can see on your screen, as far as meal breaks, in California, employers must provide employees with an off-duty meal period of no less than 30 minutes when they work 5 consecutive hours. And if an employee works 10 consecutive hours, they're entitled to 2 meal periods. Now, for a meal period to be considered off-duty and therefore unpaid, employees must be relieved of all duties during the entire 30-minute meal period and must be free to leave the employer's premises. An on-duty meal period may apply when the nature of work prevents the employee from being relieved of all duty, or when by written agreement between the employee and the employer, an on-the-job meal period is agreed to. On-duty meal periods must be counted as hours worked and must be paid at the employee's regular rate of pay. And we do note that special rules may apply for employees in the motion picture industries and other niche situations. But we would also note if an employer fails to provide an employee a meal period as required, the employer must pay 1 additional hour of pay at the employee's regular rate of pay for each workday that the meal period is not provided. And that additional hour of pay, though, is not counted as hours worked for purposes of overtime calculations.
Well, thank you, Stacy. Now, let's take a look at these rest breaks. Now, under the federal law, employers are not generally required to provide breaks to employees, but if the breaks are provided, you must follow certain rules. So, if you provide rest breaks lasting 20 minutes or less, they must be paid. Employers also are required to provide a reasonable amount of break time for a nursing mother to express milk. Now, these breaks must be provided as frequently as needed for up to 1 year after the child's birth. Now, employees must have access to a private space other than a bathroom. That's just important to note. And also, these breaks may be unpaid, but if you already offer paid breaks and an employee uses that break time to express milk, she must be compensated in the same way that other employees are being compensated for the break time. Now, some states have similar requirements and or, you know, they may offer additional protection for nursing mothers. So again, you know, you need to make sure you check your state law to ensure compliance. But just like I said before, California has different rules. So, Stacy, what are the requirements in California?
Under California law, employers must authorize and permit rest periods of no less than 10 minutes to certain non-exempt employees for every 4 hours worked or major fraction thereof. And a major fraction is interpreted as more than 2 hours. Rest periods should be in the middle of the work period to the extent practicable, and they are not required for employees whose total daily work time is less than 3.5 hours. Rest periods are counted as time worked, and employees must be paid for the time spent on their rest breaks. If an employer fails to provide an employee with any required rest period, the employer must pay one additional hour of pay at the employee's regular rate of pay for each workday that the rest period is not provided. So that means that if an employer, for some reason, does not provide one or more of the rest periods in a workday, the employee is entitled to one additional hour of pay for that workday, not one additional hour of pay for each rest period that was not provided during that workday.
Well, thank you, Stacy. Now, we wanted to remind our audience that California is not the only state with meals and rest break laws. So here's an eye chart for you that shows the meals and rest break requirements for just a few other states. Now, as you can see, many other states have meals and rest break laws too. So if you're a multi-state employer, be sure to check the requirements where your employees are working in order to stay in compliance. So let's take a look at some of the best practices and avoidable mistakes with respect to meals and rest breaks. Now, first, it is important to establish policy that requires employees to record all time worked and all meal breaks taken. It is also a best practice to require employees to provide written or electronic acknowledgement or of receipt of the policy, as well as require employees to report meals and rest breaks that they miss voluntarily. Now, this should include electronic or paper forms. Another best practice is to require that employees review and attest to the accuracy of their weekly or biweekly time records, including meal periods and rest periods, and require them to expressly indicate on the time record if they did not receive proper meal or rest period. So, you know, all of that is really important to look at. So let's shift gears and take a look at the split shift pay. Now, a number of states require employers to pay a premium in certain situations where the employees are required to work what is known as a split shift. Now, we will focus on the rules in California and New York since they are the two of the largest states. But again, you know, other states may have similar requirements. So, Stacey, can you tell us a little bit about California's split shift rules? But before you go there, you know, first of all, what is a split shift?
A split shift is a work schedule that is interrupted by non-paid and non-working time periods as established or determined by the employer. Now, the time period between work shifts needs to be longer than a bona fide meal period and needs to be taken within the same work day to be considered a split shift. The California Division of Labor Standards Enforcement, or DLSE, takes the position that a bona fide meal period, by the way, is one that does not exceed 1 hour in length. So in California, workers may be entitled to additional pay known as a split shift premium when their schedule includes a split shift. And the premium is equal to 1 hour of pay at the rate of the minimum wage. Some other things to remember about split shift pay in California. According to the DLSE, the break between shifts cannot be a meal or rest break and must be to the benefit for the employer for a split shift to be triggered. So if an employee voluntarily picks up an extra shift or if the employee requests the break for their own convenience, then no split shift premium is owed. And the rationale for that is that the purpose of the split shift premium is to prevent abuses by employers in scheduling shifts that are not voluntary. Also, if an employee does get paid a split shift premium, remember that that amount is not considered payment for time worked and does not need to be included in the employee's regular rate of pay for overtime purposes.
So are all employees working on split shift in California always entitled to be paid a split shift premium?
No, actually, no. It depends on what their hourly rate is. And an employee who is paid more than minimum wage may also be due a split shift premium. However, the greater the wage that they receive, the lower the premium will be and the lower the chance that they will even be owed a split shift premium.
So, Stacey, how do you know whether an employee is entitled to a split shift premium?
Well, there's a specific calculation that employers need to go through, and the calculation is actually the same as the way split shift premiums are calculated in New York, and we have a sample calculation on our next slide that we can run through.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So let's go through New York then.
Great. So the New York split shift rule works the same way as the California rule, and on the slide, we provided an example of the calculation. So to walk through it, to determine whether a split shift premium is due, we multiply the number of hours worked plus 1 times the minimum wage. Then we multiply the number of hours worked by the rate earned by the employee and subtract a second number from the first. If the total amount in the first calculation exceeds the total amount in the second, an employer must pay a split shift premium, and the premium due will be the difference between the two figures. However, if the total amount in the second calculation exceeds the total amount in the first, a split shift premium is not due. So, in the example you see on your screen, the employee earning minimum wage is entitled to a split shift premium, but the employee earning more than minimum wage is not.
Well, thank you, Stacey. That was very helpful. Now, can you tell us about the New York spread of hours requirement?
Sure. Spread of hours is the interval between the beginning and the end of an employee's workday. And the spread of hours for any day includes working time plus time off for meals and intervals off duty. In New York, non-exempt employees whose workdays exceed 10 hours must receive an additional hour of extra pay at the basic minimum hourly rate, which again may differ depending on where the employee is working in the state of New York, as different locations in New York have different minimum wages, in addition to pay for actual hours worked. Now, the additional hour of pay owed cannot be offset by credits for meal or lodging provided to an employee. Additionally, as with split shift pay, the additional hour is not a payment for time worked, and so it can be excluded from an employee's regular rate of pay when calculating overtime pay. Now, we point out that the rules are slightly different in the hospitality industry, which we're not going to get into here.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So here's a scenario for you. We have Jerry, who works in a hospital as a janitor from 8 a.m. to noon, and then again from 4 p.m. to 10 p.m. So, Stacey, is Jerry entitled to a split shift or spread of hours premium?
Well, because the spread of hours for the day exceeds 10, Jerry is entitled to an additional hour of pay at minimum wage. Additionally, in this case, Jerry worked a split shift. However, where, as in cases like this, both the spread of hours and split shift rules are triggered, an employee is only entitled to one premium for the same day. So Jerry is only entitled to a single premium here.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So let's switch gears and review scheduling laws. Now, we don't have scheduling laws at the federal level, but they are becoming more and more popular at the state and local level. So, Stacey, what are some of the common provisions found in scheduling laws, or the Fair Workweek laws, as they are often called?
Well, while all of the laws differ slightly in key particulars, there are a number of similar elements to them. So, for example, these laws tend to require that employers provide a certain amount of advance notice to employees before scheduling them. And then if last-minute schedule changes are necessary, employers may have to pay a penalty, for example, with a change made with less than a week's notice or less than 48 hours advance notice. Some laws also restrict the use of scheduling employees to be on call. And in these cases, if an employee is scheduled to be on call but ends up not getting called into work, the employer may be required to pay the employee a certain amount, like an hour at the employee's regular rate of pay. Also, some laws prohibit what's referred to as clopening, or the practice of scheduling employees with very little time between shifts, such as closing one night and opening the next morning. some of these laws prohibit employers from hiring additional workers on a contract, independent contractor, or part-time basis unless the employer has first offered additional hours to existing employees. Most of the laws, though, include a carve-out where employers do not have to offer hours to existing employees if to do so would require those employees to work overtime. Some of the laws also include a carve-out for employers that are subject to collective bargaining agreements with the union. Most of these scheduling laws also include notice posting and record-keeping requirements, and some even include a private right of action for employees who believe that their employers have violated the laws.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So what jurisdictions have laws like this? Can you please give us some examples?
Yeah, there are a number of them. The most recently passed predictive scheduling law is the Chicago Fair Work Week Ordinance, which was passed on July 24th, 2019, so very recently. And that law is set to take effect on July 1st, 2020, and it will apply to employers with, one, at least 100 total employees or 250 total employees for nonprofits, two, at least 50 employees covered by the ordinance, and three, employers that are primarily engaged in business in a covered industry. Covered employees under the law include those who are physically present in the city of Chicago for the majority of their work time, who perform the majority of their work in a covered industry for a covered employer, and who earn $50,000 a year or less for salaried employees, or $26 an hour or less for hourly employees. Now, there are other requirements that are summarized in your screen, which we're not going to read to you, but as you can see, this is one of the broadest Fair Work Week laws that we've seen to date.
Well, thank you, Stacey. And what about Philadelphia? It has a fair scheduling law too, doesn't it?
It does. Back in December of 2018, the Philadelphia City Council passed the Fair Work Week Employment Standards Ordinance, which will become effective in Philadelphia on January 1st, 2020. And that law applies to employers in the retail, fast food, and hotel industries with more than 30 locations and 250 employees. I won't read all of the requirements to you, but you can see some of them there on your screen.
Well, thank you, Stacey. So, you know, now here you can see a summary of other relatively recent state and local fair work week laws. Now, to date, Oregon is the only state with a statewide scheduling law, but other states, such as New York, are considering similar measures. Now, we won't read all of this to you, but as you can see, that there are differences between these laws, but there are also similarities. Now, the idea behind all of them is to limit unpredictability of the work schedules of employees in industries such as fast food and retail. So, Stacey, are there any fair scheduling laws in California?
Yes, there are. As with many other employee-friendly policies, cities within the state of California were at the forefront in passing fair scheduling laws. The laws are listed on the slide in chronological order in which they were passed. So the San Francisco and San Jose laws were passed first, followed by the Emeryville, California law, which took effect in July of 2017. The San Francisco Retail Employee Rights Act applies to any chain retail establishment with at least 40 retail establishments located worldwide and then employs 20 or more employees in the city of San Francisco, and that number includes corporate officers or executives. The city of San Jose's law is not limited to the fast food or retail industries. It applies to employers with more than 35 employees. The San Jose ordinance does not require notice before scheduling employees or a minimum of time between shifts, but it does require that before hiring additional employees or subcontractors, an employer must offer additional hours of work to existing employees. The Emeryville Fair Work Week Act took effect just a little more than 2 years ago on July 1st, 2017. And it applies to fast food and retail firms with 56 or more employees globally. In the fast food sector, employers must also have 20 or more employees in the city limits of Emeryville in order to be covered. Now, there are lots of moving parts with each of these laws, and they're all still fairly new, so we don't have a lot of precedent to look at to see how they're going to be applied or enforced. But if you have locations in any of these jurisdictions, you're really going to want to pay close attention to the particulars of the law that affect you.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Now, our next topic is compliance considerations and best practices. So let's start out with reviewing the different types of wage and hour lawsuits. And as the data suggests, collective action lawsuits filed under the FLSA have increased significantly. And as you can imagine, wage and hour cases under the FLSA, they come in a variety of types. So Stacey, what are some good examples of common wage and hour claims?
Oh, there are a number of them, and they have increased over the years. So I will start with misclassification cases. Now, in misclassification cases, an employer mistakenly classifies an employee as exempt instead of non-exempt and then fails to record that employee's hours or fails to pay them overtime for hours worked in excess of 40 per week. Another kind of misclassification can occur when employers designate a worker as an independent contractor, but really they should be considered an employee who is entitled to overtime and minimum wage. Other types of FLSA cases include claims where employees are working without being paid for their time. And these are often called off-the-clock claims, and they can include cases where employees are required to perform work before or after their scheduled shifts, such as donning and doffing required uniforms or protective equipment, or cases where employees allege that they've been told to clock out and keep working or to perform some work before they clock in. Other types of wage and hour cases, not at the federal level but at the state level, include meal and rest break cases, which obviously typically occur in states with specific meal and rest break requirements, and most notably in California. Also specific to California are class actions based on wage statement violations. And this is because California has very, very specific requirements as to what must appear on an employee's wage statement. In fact, we've done entire webinars on the topic of California wage statement requirements. Suffice it to say for now that if you have employees in California, you need to review the requirements of California Labor Code Section 226A and make sure that your wage statements meet all of them. Now, another area where we've seen an explosion of class action litigation involves the use of biometric technology in the state of Illinois. Well, strictly speaking, these aren't really wage and hour cases. They're allegedly employee privacy cases. The law that they're brought under in Illinois is called the Illinois Biometric Information Privacy Act, and it imposes requirements around how companies can collect, store, and use biometric information. For our purposes, though, they may relate to employer timekeeping, since a number of these cases have arisen out of employers' use of biometric time clocks.
Well, thank you, Stacey, and that was a lot to consider. So, as you can see from all of the topics we covered today, the bottom line is that you have to keep up with compliance, document everything, and make sure your policies and processes are consistent and help mitigate risks. Now, this can be hard, as it's not easy to keep up with the changes and actually understand, track, and implement all these programs. And if you don't do it right, it may lead to expensive fines and penalties, including awards and lawsuits. So with that in mind, let's look at what should employers do now. So here you can see a list of examples of best practices. So most importantly, make sure you follow the rules. There's plenty of complexity out there, so track the laws, the rules, the case law, and understand how they affect your policies and procedures, and remember all of the touch points. Also, remember the basics. According to the Department of Labor, most common mistakes include execution on the basics. In addition to that, make sure you update your handbook, provide required notices, policies, and standard communications. Courts will typically give deference to the employer's policies as long as they are clearly written, they're clearly communicated, and consistently applied. Now, another best practice is to integrate with payroll, leave management, and your company's attendance program. So you got to make sure that you train your managers to avoid those wage and hour lawsuits. Now, we've said this before, but I'd like to reiterate that documentation is everything. It is not enough to just do it right. You have to be able to prove that you did it right. And, you know, this is the truth in both the DOL as well as the court context. And finally, when in doubt, you've got to consult with your legal advisor. Now, we've mentioned this several times today, the importance of consulting with your legal advisor when you have a question. Now, it's important to remember that factual scenarios, they may seem similar, but may differ significantly in outcome, and every organization has its own sense of risk preference and risk avoidance. So, you know, you might have a point of view around that. Now, we are almost at the end of today's session, and we'd like to close with future outlook. So I'd like to say that it's really important to recognize that the landscape of employment-related laws is constantly shifting all across the country. So it is important for employers to continuously monitor new developments that may apply to their workplaces wherever they are located. Now, here on your screen, you can see a list of items for you to keep an eye out for, starting out with the DOL's proposed overtime regulation, the minimum wage changes at the state and local level, and overtime laws, scheduling laws, court decisions, opinion letters, and much, much more. So you got to stay tuned and keep abreast of all these changing regulations. With that, I'll pass it back to Karen. So back to you, Karen.
Thank you so much, Sushma and Stacey, for all that valuable information. And we are at the top of the hour. So unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the Thank You for Attending email. And if you requested CPE when you registered, you will be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. And on behalf of Sushma, Stacey, myself, and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you and have a great rest of your day.